So my name is Katie Rogers. I'm the president of the Catalogue Raisonné Scholars Association and the Robert Motherwell Catalogue Raisonné Director here at the Dedalus Foundation. I'm excited to welcome you all here tonight for what should be a really exciting and interesting evening. All of the speakers who are generously giving their time, I want to say thank you first of all, but also to Carl Schmitz, our Director of Communications at the Catalogue Raisonné Scholars Association. Carl has been key in putting this panel together. This panel is one of many initiatives that CRSA has been focusing on recently. In the past several years, we've found that the members are really interested in talking about case studies and looking at how individuals, what their plan of attack is in terms of the type of research we all do. We all have crossover in terms of the basic elements of a catalogue raisonné, but we all do it a little bit differently. We all kind of reinvent the wheel, but we have a lot to learn from each other. I've always loved the catalogue raisonné world because everyone is so generous with their knowledge, and I think you'll find that to be the case tonight. So this panel is being recorded. The entirety will be recorded, including Q&A. We will post this on our YouTube channel in a few weeks when we have the edited version. And you'll find other videos up there from past programs, and we hope to do that on an ongoing basis. So I will turn this over to Carl. First thing, of course, little housekeeping is if everyone would turn off their cell phones and please help yourself to any of the food or drinks. We will have a reception afterward. Carl.
Thank you, Katie. On behalf of the other officers of the Catalogue Raisonné Scholars Association, I'd like to thank Katie as well as the Dedalus Foundation for being such excellent hosts. Quick note about this program. Which that it was largely inspired by a panel that was at the College Art Association earlier this year on provenance research. And provenance research being such a big part of what we do as Catalogue Raisonné scholars seems like such a natural, organic topic for a panel by the CRSA. It's also, interestingly enough, something that we don't often talk about because there's so much we can't talk about. So it'll be very interesting to see how these speakers, especially our speakers coming from the Catalogue Raisonné world, approach that topic. I'd also like to express thanks to Jane Milosh, director of the Smithsonian Provenance Research Institute. She was a great sounding board in the development of this program. She couldn't make it here today, but I wanted to let everybody know that she's very active with some panels that are being put together for AAM later this month in Washington. There's going to be a panel entitled Today's Looted Art Equals Tomorrow's Provenance Program Problem. That's going to be the morning of May 26th. And the Smithsonian Provenance Research Institute is also hosting a half-day program also on the 26th entitled Provenance, Beyond Due Diligence to Grand Collections Stories, From World War II Era to Antiquities, Global to Local, Philosophical to the Practical. And that's going to be a collection of talks as well as tours, guest speakers, and how-to discussions. And we also have two copies of a special issue of Collections from summer of 2014, which was dedicated to provenance. We don't have these for sale, just for personal edification. And our first speaker, Christel Force, was also a contributor to that issue of Collections. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Christel Force, our first speaker, who is Associate Research Curator, Modern and Contemporary at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Christel Force at the Met has contributed research and documentation for a number of catalogs. She has an MA from McGill University and a PhD in art history from the Graduate Center, City University of New York. Force's prior contributions to the field of provenance include curatorial work at the Museum of Modern Art and the Guggenheim Museum, and spearheading the provenance research project at MoMA. In her current position, she's conducting research on the provenance of paintings and drawings for exhibition catalogs documenting the Met's permanent collection, such as Picasso in the Met Museum of in the Metropolitan Art, Museum of Art 2010, Stieglitz and its artists, 2011, and loan shows such as Matisse in Search of True Painting from 2012, as well as research and a special focus on the World War II era. Please join me in welcoming Christel.
Thank you. I've been asked to talk about my experience as someone who's been conducting provenance research for many years in three museums in New York, at the Guggenheim, at MoMA, and currently at the Metropolitan Museum. Some of what I will say may perhaps not be so relevant to Catalogue Raisonné scholars. However, I'm here to represent a museum curator's perspective, and also to characterize the big shift in 1997 when World War II era issues came to the forefront. First, I will brush a broad picture of my experience thus far, and then I will address the question of the way in which, 20 years in, we can improve careers in provenance research by broadening our current myopic view of ownership history and placing it in the larger context of the history of collecting and the historical art market. In order to accomplish this, I suggest bridging the gap between the academic approach in Germany and museum practices in the US. Provenance research has always been an intricate part of curatorial work in art museums, yet I never learned it in undergraduate or graduate school. That hasn't changed. I've recently asked several interns and fellows at the Met. None of them had any training in provenance research in any of the graduate programs in art history they attended. I worked in the curatorial department of painting and sculpture at MoMA in the 90s. At first, to me and to my peers, provenance research meant collating information from the relevant catalogue Raisonné and sending out a few letters. Only experienced art dealers and the authors of catalogue Raisonnés, the two being often one and the same, were truly knowledgeable about provenance. And I find this last point interesting, if only as an aside here. Indeed, I'd like to point out that art dealers were the foremost catalogue Raisonné scholars in the 20th century. You may have spent some time thinking about this. The obvious examples that come to mind are Zervos on Picasso. He and his wife owned a gallery. César de Hoc and Hector Bram on Seurat. Jean and Henri d'Auberville on Bonnard. Guy Patrice and Michel d'Auberville, catalogue Raisonné of Henri Matisse chez Bernheim Jeune. Georges Wildenstein on Morisseau. Daniel Wildenstein on Monet and Manet. Daniel and Guy Wildenstein on Chardin and David. Klaus Perls on Pasquin and Soutine. Feilschenfeld on Cézanne, etc., etc. And as you know, the Wildenstein Institute is a veritable catalogue Raisonné industry to this day. Knowing who the collectors were and keeping track of the artwork's whereabouts, as well as prices, were an integral part of the dealer's job, more so than for curators even. Accessing and recording this information was a time-consuming endeavor. Knowledge being power, these were precious trade secrets before the internet made everything accessible to anyone. Curators compiled provenance information to document their collection rather than proactively researched it. Accessing dealer records to track down transfers was neither typical nor for the most part possible until recently. And some galleries, like Quentin Laurence at Galerie Louise Leris or Guy Patrice d'Auberville at Galerie Bernheim Jeune, still operate, or so it seems, under the assumption that their records are no one else's business. But I digress. I started out doing provenance research the way it had always been done. You had acquisition papers for works in the permanent collection, which typically include whatever the donor or seller provided, and you checked the catalogue Raisonné. You'd write to the prior owner or the dealers in the provenance, if they were still around, and asked if they had any records regarding prior ownership. You were lucky if they responded at all. You did not typically double-guess the response or the lack thereof. When I compiled the provenance of artworks included in a loan show, it was only one of many curatorial tasks, such as research for the catalogue essay, documentary photographs, correspondence with the lenders, getting the completed loan forms back, which included a section on provenance usually returned blank or with minimal information. Then there was a small matter of coordinating the various facets of the show with the editors and the designers of the catalogue in the publications department, the wall text handouts, lectures with education, the press release, reproductions and captions with communications, the labels and wall text with exhibition design, and other matters with the conservation department, the frame studio, the registrars, etc. This was the job. I used the services of the Art Loss Register. We relied on their database of stolen art. There wasn't much time for additional research. Of course, every institution is different. MoMA typically didn't include provenance or references in its exhibition or collection catalogs, whereas the Met often did and still does. Before provenance became topical, the Met made concerted efforts to document the ownership history of artworks, especially when they planned the publication of collection catalogs, such as Charles Sterling and Margareta Salinger's multi-volume French paintings, a catalog of the collection of the Metropolitan Museum of Art published in the 50s and 60s. The provenance of this Ingres, which is I picked randomly, is framed in red. Then things changed in the second half of the 90s with the publication of Lynn Nicholas's The Rape of Europa in 94 and Hector Feliciano's The Lost Museum in 97, compounded by the Schiele debacle at MoMA, which brought the issue of Nazi art looting to the forefront. For those of you who were too young at the time, in 97, during an Egon Schiele exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art, an article in the New York Times revealed the story of Portrait of Wally, a painting lent by the Leopold Museum in Vienna, which had been sold under duress by its Jewish owner, Leah Bondy-Jahai, during the Nazi era. At the request of the latter's heirs, the New York County District Attorney issued a subpoena preventing the return of the canvas to Austria as Bondy's heirs demanded restitution. The work was tied up in litigation for many years until 2010. At that point, provenance research became a high museum priority. This event, which had caused the breach of a loan agreement contract, not to mention widespread consternation, and the worry that tainted artworks might have found their way to American museums as well, this event and those books, prompted the creation of the Presidential Advisory Commission on Holocaust Assets with the United States in June of 1998 to report to the president on issues relating to Holocaust victims' assets in the U.S. From that time, museums would heed the recommendations of the American Alliance of Museums, the AAM for short, and the Association of Art Museum Directors, the AAMD. In 97, a task force was convened by the AAMD to draft guidelines on the restitution of art stolen by the Nazis. This report formed the basis of the Washington Principles, drafted by the Washington Conference on Holocaust-Era Assets of December of 98. This, in turn, was followed by the AAM's recommended procedures for providing information to the public about objects transferred in Europe during the Nazi era and other such edicts. In 2001, the AAM Guide to Provenance Research was published, which is still a very useful resource to this day. The AAMD also created the Nazi-era provenance internet portal, or NEPIP, in 2003. NEPIP is a searchable registry of objects in U.S. museum collections that changed hands in continental Europe during the Nazi era to facilitate claimants' pursuit of lost property. According to the site, there are currently close to 30,000 objects from 176 participating museums listed in the portal. The portal, though, is a bit obsolete. This is merely the tip of the iceberg. The provenance of many additional objects has been posted online on those museums' websites. The research is a constant work in progress. New gaps are found and filled every day, and all the online provenance research projects are updated daily. Needless to say, we've made great strides in the 20-year period since 1997. Don't get me wrong, there was awareness of Nazi art looting prior to that. One of the monuments men, James Rorimer, was director of the cloisters from 1949 and director of the Met from 1955 to his death in 66. He was the character portrayed by Matt Damon in George Clooney's The Monuments Man. And Ted Rousseau, chief curator of European paintings at the Met from 1946, had been a key figure of the art looting investigation unit of the Office of Strategic Services. But that wasn't enough. Before, provenance was one of the museum curator's many tasks, which they executed at certain junctures, at the time of acquisition and in view of the publication of a collection catalog, mostly. They had neither the time nor the staff to do much more, considering the fact that we're talking about thousands of objects and that curators are very busy curating loan exhibitions. Now, most museums budget provenance research among other curatorial expenses and hire dedicated full-time staff to focus on proactive research. Before, the provenance of artworks in American museums was kept in curatorial files and in collection catalogs. It was not easily accessible unless you were a very well-versed scholar. It was incomplete and obsolete by nature, as the research period was constrained by deadlines, and oftentimes it wasn't revisited for decades. Now, our provenance research is constant and easily accessible to anyone online. Before, the main impetus of provenance research was to assess the pedigree of an object, as its inclusion in an illustrious collection is historically significant. The ownership history of an artwork had also been an effective way to confirm its attribution, especially when its whereabouts could be traced back to the artist's lifetime or a fine connoisseur. Alphonse Kahn, for instance, was a desirable provenance. Provenance is also paramount to establish that good title has passed. Title, attribution, and pedigree are, of course, germane to the artwork's marketability. Today, aside from that, the primary motivation is to detect any possible episode of looting, for sale, or cultural property theft. For instance, an Alphonse Kahn provenance today is a red flag. Every measure has to be taken to ascertain whether the work was looted by the ERR during the occupation. Before, very few gallery records were accessible to researchers, and for those records that were available, finding aids were the exception rather than the rule. And thus, finding anything was like looking for a needle in a haystack. Now, finding aids are a common currency, and more archives are being digitized and only a click away on our screen. At first, after 97, the mandate was to focus on Judaica and European paintings. Now, we systematically update and post our research on drawings, sculptures, decorative arts, non-Western art, etc. At first, the focus was on the period 1933 to 45. Now, we research and post most objects in our collections, including post-World War II American art. Of course, the feasibility and the limits of research on multiples, such as prints or bronzes, for instance, is undeniable. And although museums are expected to devote limitless amounts of staff time to provenance research, there are limits. We typically spend several days on any single artwork, occasionally several weeks, but not months or years, as would be required to fully iron out every question or gap. That's what the NEPIP portal and what our websites are for. There are gaps out there, and if you have information or questions, please come forward. The bottom line is this: American museums have spent and are spending an enormous amount of time and resources on provenance research. When I spearheaded the provenance research project at MoMA in 2001, initially the idea was to make the information we had in our files or in prior publications available online all in one place. The first steps were to identify the relevant works, about 800, and consolidate the existing provenance data, and subsequently to deepen the research and fill the gaps. I organized my research by artists so as to cover the whole literature and the relevant archives for each one, like you would do for a catalogue raisonné. Progressively, provenance research in general and Holocaust-era restitution issues in particular were becoming a new field of expertise, and the job was now a full-time one. When I came to the Met 11 years ago now, my task in the Department of Impressionist, Modern, and Contemporary Art was completely different. It involved a lot of provenance research still, but instead of researching the collection by artists and feeding the provenance in the provenance research project online, my new boss had his team of curators work together on exhibition catalogs, which included large segments of reference material. Our research was geared towards documenting a particular collection or dealer. For starters, I researched all the works included in our Volard exhibition, which was a loan show. I also worked on a Matisse loan show, but mostly I did such work for catalogs dedicated to the Met's permanent collection. such as the Muriel Newman, the Pierre Matisse, and the Alfred Stieglitz collections. I researched all the Picassos in our collection also for such a catalog published in 2010, which I am showing you here. And I'm showing you a sample entry with the provenance framed in red, minimal. After the publication of those catalogs, the research was fed into our collection database system, TMS, from which our website pulls, so that this research is now also available online. It also gets updated online as need be. At the Met, each department conducts research in its own particular way. Other museums have a more centralized way of approaching provenance matters. And so some researchers work from prehistoric art all the way to contemporary art. The peculiar nature of my work is that I have been able to focus exclusively on Impressionist and modern art, whereas some colleagues are overseeing a much wider range of the history of art, from cultural property matters to Holocaust era issues, and from decorative art to non-Western art and the fine arts. As you can see, there are various ways of approaching provenance research in a museum. Now that the importance of provenance is firmly established, I would argue that we need to promote awareness of this gargantuan undertaking and to make it more interesting and palatable to the outside world. In order to accomplish this, I believe we need to tell the full, fleshed-out stories to show the human dimension and the broader relevance of provenance as it unfolded within the specific economic, political, and social context. In American museums, though, provenance experts present the bare bones version of their sleuthing as a string of facts, the who, what, when, where, how, as it appears in catalogs and online. From there on, the authorless research enters the public domain. Ironically, no one owns ownership history. The corollary of this lack of authorship is that one doesn't know how much time and expertise went into any particular provenance online. Was it done by an intern, by a curator 30 years ago, and not revisited since, or by an experienced specialist recently? Our museums take an unduly narrow view of provenance, and researchers rarely get a chance to elaborate on the significance of their findings for reasons ranging from time constrictions and lack of opportunity to legal confidentiality clauses. This can be a deterrent for PhDs. The job of a provenance researcher is to list names, dates, and prices, and yet there would be so much to gain from telling the captivating stories surrounding the bare-bones string of facts we're all familiar with. Let me give you an example. It's the provenance, I'm warning you, of a very racy blue period painting that I researched for the Picasso catalog I already mentioned. The provenance is framed in red. I started with a major gap from 1903 to 1924, of little consequence in terms of World War II related issues, but again, that is not the only reason why we conduct provenance research. Getting these few lines together was a challenge, given that I had to research the provenance and compile the exhibition history and references for about 100 Picassos in less than a year. Here is what the provenance currently looks like online. The condensed provenance has been pieced together from unpublished documents in private hands in Barcelona and Geneva, and in other archival records in Edinburgh, Paris, and New Haven. It represents a huge amount of work, of which only the tip of the proverbial iceberg is visible. Sometimes an entire day of work results, as you know, in the mere replacement of one date for another, which may or may not be significant. Sometimes an expensive trip to another city represents the addition of one line, 20 words. However, in this particular case, I had the opportunity to share the full story in a focus issue of the journal Collections, dedicated to provenance research conducted in American museums. This focus issue is unique. It is the first and thus far the only such publication in the US. Evidently, we would need many more to adequately represent the breadth and depth of what we've achieved and what we continue to accomplish every day in American museums, which, by the way, are constantly accused of not doing enough and not fast enough in the press and at conferences. I am showing you some pages of this article to give you an idea of the narrative required to adequately articulate the provenance of this painting, its significance, and its implications. The findings outlined in this particular article are a matter of some importance, as thus far the authenticity of the blue painting had been in question. Not only does the ownership history of this canvas deserve a full exposé, but it also completes the provenance and highlights the significance of a cubist still life that was attached to this erotic scene for a while, as I discovered. Moreover, the narrative of the research itself would be quite entertaining. Such stories can be riveting. There's no doubt that those stories make great books. To it, the portrait of Dr. Gachet, the hair with the amber eyes, the lady in gold, not to mention the movie Woman in Gold. It doesn't even have to be a real story. Fiction will do, as some novels exemplify. That's how the public at large views it, provenance as a detective novel or as a movie. No one wants to look at a dry string of facts any more than at the chronology of an artist's life summarized in bullet points. It could never carry the same weight or move the reader as a proper biography does. The same applies to the life of artworks. But in American museums today, as a rule, those who conduct provenance research do not publish essays. In the museum world, publications are usually attached to exhibitions, and other research pertains to academia. But the academic milieu in the US looks down on provenance research. For most of my colleagues, the occasions to elaborate on and share their findings are scarce. This is one of the reasons why there are so few provenance research with true expertise. The few who have endured are those, a minority, who have managed to combine provenance research with curatorial work, lecturing, teaching, publishing, which enables them to share their findings. The vast majority have not and move on. The problem is all the more dire that with provenance research, proficiency is essentially conditional upon experience and networking. However, there is an academic culture where provenance research is respected and publishing is encouraged, and that's Germany, in fact, probably because it hits a raw nerve. I am showing you some examples of German publications, the likes of which we simply don't have in the US. The faculty in programs that teach provenance research in German universities publish on topics such as the collectors of modern art in a specific region, the dealers active between the wars, the fate of degenerate art, exiled collectors, and banished dealers during the Third Reich, etc. Rather than merely extracting a specific object's ownership history from the archival records, such publications put the data in historical context. I lost my line. And distill a broader argument. The first exercise, the object-based sleuthing, which is the museum researcher's fair, is a necessary but more short-sighted endeavor. A fine balance between the two approaches is more likely to retain a scholar's interest. The authors who publish their subject-based scholarship lend more authority and visibility to the research. Those publications give a voice to the experts. Or museums could learn from the German approach, which is less myopic and puts provenance in context. In the US, we have a scarcity of publications of the same type. We have the likes of this book about the front page news Gurlitt affair, and otherwise exceptions such as these, which confirm the rule, one with the apologetic title Provenance, an alternate history of art, and the other strictly about Chinese ceramic. What keeps me interested at this point is not just research the provenance or of this or that object, but to fine-tune my grasp of the art market for modern art in the first half of the 20th century, to piece together a disseminated collection or the career of a dealer who played a seminal role in those years. To conclude, I would posit that to focus on the big picture is more productive in the long run. It enables us to put our expertise to good use for future researchers. It conveys the human dimension behind the string of names. It addresses the art historical relevance of what otherwise might seem like meaningless, isolated facts. It lets us see the forest through the trees. If we want to make the job more attractive for the next generation, we have to reconcile the curatorial and the academic approaches.
All right, hi everyone. So I'm gonna be showing you some slides, and as Christel touched upon, there are many issues in provenance research that are linked to the art market and are essential to the art market. And what I'm here to tell you is how provenance research basically helps or hinders the art market and the saleability of given works of art. The first slide I'm showing you is just one of our former auctioneers, Henry Wyndham, asking the audience, are you sure? And usually this question is posited not to the potential bidder, but to the underbidder who's given up. I think, as a provenance researcher, this question should be asked to the person who's about to spend their $60 million on the painting. Okay. All right, so now you're looking at Nadia Leger. So Nadia Leger, interestingly, was an art student, and rumor has it, and it's been somewhat of an accepted fact in the art market, that Nadia Leger forged a lot of Leger's paintings, especially the ones that were omitted from the Bokeh series. So no one ever would put this in writing, of course, and Nadia Leger is excellent provenance for works by Leger, but there is some question when a work is not listed in the Bokeh catalog, Raisonné, whether or not it was by Leger or by Nadia. Now, a great example of this that someone has written about most recently is a painting that belonged to Peggy Guggenheim, and for many, many years, many scholars, including Douglas Cooper, doubted the authenticity of this early Leger. Interestingly, no one really comes forward saying who gave it to the Guggenheim, to Peggy Guggenheim. Leger's dealer, Kahnweiler, received a cache of incredible works on paper by Leger that he swore had an excellent provenance, and no one doubted him. And it turned out that a lot of those works have been proven as being forgeries. Unfortunately for the Guggenheim Museum in Venice, this was the case, and it was proven to be a forgery, thanks largely to carbon-14 dating. Pigment was tested on the canvas, and this is something that, and forgive me for getting this wrong, I really just learned about this. Apparently, there was a certain level of radioactive isotopes after the atomic bomb that lingered in the atmosphere. And with a lot of atomic testing occurring, that isotope increased, so much so that organic substances began to take it on, like linseed or cotton. So when there was carbon-14 dating done for this picture that was at the Guggenheim, it was found that it had high levels of this particular isotope that would not have existed prior to 1955. Now that type of dating and that type of research does not happen overnight. It takes an incredible amount of dedication, time, and money to uncover a forgery like this Leger. Douglas Cooper certainly writes about the whole instance with Kahnweiler and the problems of Leger, as does John Richardson, and you're seeing John Richardson's book, The Sorcerer's Apprentice, where he talks about the problems with Leger. But no one has really dedicated the resources, particularly within the span of time that a transaction takes place. Now, one of the slides I'm going to show you here is a slide of Modigliani. And Modigliani, of course, is one of the hot artists that undergoes a lot of controversy in the world of provenance. The language I've printed here is the language that Sotheby's valuation department tells clients when they come to us for an estate tax appraisal. If a Modigliani was purchased at Sotheby's or elsewhere in the 60s or 70s or 80s or 90s or even as early as the early 2000s, if it doesn't fall under these four categories, either recorded in the Chironi catalog Raisonné, traced back to the archives of Paul Guillaume, coming from the collection of Paul Alexandre, or having a documented provenance back to the artist, namely a photograph of Modigliani standing in front of the painting, we can't put a value on it. That is not to say that the painting is fake. It's to say that in today's market, if the painting were to go up, come up for auction or be presented for sale, no one would buy it. Now, whether or not that's right or wrong is certainly open for debate, but until the market decides collectively what to do about these works by Modigliani, that's certainly could very well be Modigliani's, we are at a standstill, and it's very, very troubling for a lot of our clients who do come to us asking us to put a value on a picture that under any one of these conditions would be worth $20 million, but instead we're telling them it's worth nothing. Now, when does the auction house intervene? Now, it's a very important point. Bear in mind that for any sale, we are usually given a consignment about 3 weeks on average before we go to press with our catalog. And when a client is very important to us, has a large collection behind the consignment, you know, certainly with all of our clients, we want to do as much as we can. But when we're presented with a work of art, particularly one that we sold to the client, and it comes back from the experts with an unfavorable determination, then not only is our reputation on the line, but our relationship with our client is on the line. So this is a sculpture by Gauguin that we sold to Sotheby's longstanding client in 1961 in London. And when we sold it to the collector, he just basically bought it because he liked it. He bought it out of the catalog, and it's very interesting. It has an odd provenance. It said it was coming from a member of the Dominican order, and it tells a story about how the sculpture was given to the former owner, who was a little girl, by Gauguin, who had promised her a doll. So when he got back from the South Seas in 1894, he met up with this little girl and gave her this bust in place of a doll. So sounded good. The collector purchased it in 1961, and he didn't have any doubts about it. And who would? If we look at the sculpture in comparison to a lot of the sketches that Gauguin did around the time, you see a lot of similarities that were very obvious to all of us. And then there were also what we noticed, even at Sotheby's among the experts that were looking at it, a lot of little signs that were telltale signs of Gauguin's signature. Rather than signing the work, he put these two little foxes on the back, and the fox was a symbol of sexuality and in Polynesian folklore. And it had been used in a lot of Gauguin's canvases. So none of us had any reason to doubt that this was a work by Gauguin. Moreover, it had been published in a book in 1963 by a scholar by the name of Christopher Gray, who listed it among the sculptures by Paul Gauguin. So we thought it was fine, but we customarily have to check everything with the owner, with the expert of record, who for Gauguin is the Wildenstein Institute. Now, the Wildenstein Institute, after a few weeks, came back to us with a very frustrating determination. They told us that this work was pending further research. Well, we had a sale in 3 weeks. We had an octogenarian consigner. Pending further research was not going to go over very well. Additionally, to add pressure, we had a client who was alerted to the availability of the sculpture at an upcoming auction, and they had already pledged a bid of $10 million. So we had $10 million lingering and a determination of pending further research. Now, at the time, this was in May 2011, it was for the May 2011 sale, so it was around February of 2011. There was something just odd about this work, where all of us in the Impressionist department couldn't get over the fact that this had been rejected, or at least stymied. And I, for one, became particularly intrigued. And very much like Christel said, it's when you have a particular interest in something, that's oftentimes when you take the extra effort. And I mean, I had 60 other lots to research, but this one just really got to me. And it got to me for a number of reasons. Number one, something about Gauguin's biography that's not really talked about, and that is that he was a pedophile. And it's rampant, and it's not spurious information. He was a pedophile. He took lovers who were 12 or 13-year-old girls, and this is a photograph of Gauguin with a young woman named Anna, who was 13 at the time, who was one of his lovers, or vahines, as he would call them. And you can see how crudely and blatantly he sexualizes Anna. This is a painting called Anna the Javanese with a monkey, and just it gives you all of the tropes of animal sexuality. This was incredibly disturbing to me. It always had been disturbing to me about Gauguin, and I couldn't help but just to reread this whole story about Gauguin giving this doll to a little girl. Why would he do that? And this story just was, it just had all the markings of a predator, and I started to just, my mind started to go wild. So I took the liberty of recalling all of my Catholic school days being taught by the Dominican nuns, and I knew that the Dominicans were educators, and they would probably welcome some inquiries, some scholarly inquiries. So I went online, and I located all of the Dominican monasteries in France, the priories in France, and I wrote to all of them. And interestingly, some of them wrote me back, and the ones that wrote me back said, "Your email has been circulating among all of us." It was quite intense. And they told me, we knew the name of the consigner at the time of the Sotheby's sale. His name was Father Ruzwicki. And they told me a little bit about Father Ruzwicki and how he was a very noble priest from a well-to-do aristocratic Polish family. He was very well connected. So they weren't surprised that Father Ruzwicki would have a Gauguin. But they couldn't figure out, they didn't have any information about a member of their order, who I at the time was convinced it was this little girl who, because she'd suffered at the hands of Gauguin, went to the church to try to purge herself of all these demons. That's my own narrative. But nobody could confirm this to me. But then I decided to go back to Christopher Gray. Now, Christopher Gray, again, he published this book in 1963, 2 years after the purchaser at the Sotheby's sale purchased the Gauguin. But interestingly, Christopher Gray had fallen out of favor among the scholars at the Wildenstein Institute, who were questioning the works in this book. Through a little bit of research, I found out that Christopher Gray's archives were held at Johns Hopkins University, so I took the train to Johns Hopkins. And in the midst of all of his papers, I found a card referring to the Sotheby's sale. And on the card, it says the name Jean Dolan, written twice. Written twice because it must have been dictated to him. Now, at Sotheby's, you cannot reveal the name of the consigner to anyone. It's part of our code of secrecy that we pledge to our consigner. So Christopher Gray, I'm supposing, probably went to Sotheby's and said, "Who was the consigner?" And they said, "Well, we can't tell you." And he said, "Please, I'm a researcher. I'll keep it to myself. It'll go in my archives. Nobody will ever know." And someone must have told him it's coming from this father who got it from Jean Dolant. And so he writes it down, and then he writes it down in all caps, trying to make sure he gets the spelling. And he tucks it away in his personal archives, doesn't publish the name, and the index card sits in the archives in Johns Hopkins University, probably until I found it, because those archives are not really being gone through at this point. Maybe they are, but this was a big find. So now I'm extremely excited, taking the train back to New York, and I'm Googling Jean Dolan, and I find him. There he is, the picture that I found. He was quite the intellectual at the time. He was friends with Gauguin. He was a writer, and he oftentimes threw salons at his home where artists and writers would come to discuss their work. And interestingly, his salons would occur in the presence of someone else. I Googled Jean Dolan, and I Googled daughter. And what came up but a portrait that was done in 1884 of Jean Dolan and his little girl. So around the time that Gauguin would have known her, she would have been in her early adolescence. So a little bit more research on Jean Dolan led me to a fellow who had just published his dissertation in France only months before, a fellow named Pierre Pichon, who wrote his dissertation on Jean Dolan. It had just been published in 2000. So I wrote to him, and like many dissertation writers who have just completed his dissertation, he was thrilled to talk to me about it. And he sent me a copy of his dissertation, which has been published. And in the dissertation, not only did I see another image of Jean Dolan and his adolescent daughter, who you can see there looking very uncomfortable amidst Auguste Rodin, who's sitting at the table, but I also learned that after Dolan's death in 1919, there was an auction at Drouot of his collection, at which a sculpture called Tête de Femme had failed to sell. And it was a sculpture that was retained by the family and then later sold at Sotheby's in 1961. This information the Wildenstein Institute did not have. I certainly didn't have it, and my consigner didn't have it. This information was basically sitting in this dissertation in France that was waiting to be read, and it was a miracle that I read it. So, in any case, I contacted the Wildenstein Institute with my new findings, and luckily they reversed their decision, and the sculpture sold for $11.3 million. Now, this is to say that if you want to make a work of art worth a lot of money, it doesn't necessarily take tons of sleuthing. Sometimes it just takes a credible author to publish the work in a book. But sometimes it does take a lot of dedication and a lot of trust on the part of the person who purchases the work. Because when the consigner purchased this Gauguin in 1961, he had no idea that there was ever going to be a problem with it. So I'm just going to leave you with another slide. Instead of, next time you go to an auction, looking at the auctioneer who's asking you to bid, perhaps he should be saying buyer beware rather than one more. Thank you.
I will be talking about the Archipenko Catalogue Raisonné and our provenance research. Alexander Archipenko is a challenging artist for provenance research. He lived from 1887 until 1964, in a period which included two world wars and therefore has known complicated provenance issues. Research is also difficult because of the artist's migrant lifestyle, which led him from his home country Ukraine, then part of the Russian Empire, to France, to Germany, and finally the United States in 1923. He was prolific and realized sculptural additions. Our catalogue Raisonné has currently about 1,800 entries for sculptures. As you can imagine, this biography means not only dealing with untraced artworks and incomplete documentation in several languages, but also unraveling complicated ownership histories and uncovering hidden stories. This brings me to our first case study. This work, Seated Black Torso, appeared at Phillips Auction House in 1999 with the following provenance: Nell Walde, Berlin, private collection, acquired by the uncle of the actual owner in Stuttgart on May 24, 1955. Reading this, I knew that they probably meant Nell Walden, who was Herbert Walden's second wife. And Herbert Walden was the founder of Der Sturm in Berlin, an arts organization that championed Archipenko. Looking at the object then provided the first clue, because inside the base was a label glued in. And you can see there's a reference to Der Sturm right here. And here is the rest of Herbert Walden's name. We can also clearly identify the name of the artist as Archipenko. And we see in the middle the title in German as Kauernde. And the label also tells us that this work was in the Berlin catalog number 16. Now the label seemed authentic and all the details made sense. So we went with this provenance, and we are really happy that we could trace it back to Herbert Walden. We also knew that Walden gave a large part of his collection to Nell Walden in 1919. I was then able to trace an auction in Stuttgart in Germany in 1955, and that was the sale of Nell Walden's collection. So we were able to connect those dots, and we, as you can see, we are able to fill in some details of the provenance. I would like to point out that for our catalogue Raisonné, we built a comprehensive database of auction sales records of works attributed to Archipenko, covering sales from about 1927 until today. And this is backed up by copies of the actual auction catalog entries that we assembled in many research trips, especially to the Frick and the New York Public Library. And this database has become an important tool that allows us to easily identify and cross-reference works. Another initiative that proved very successful was reaching out to public collections worldwide and asking for inventory information of their works attributed to Archipenko. We learned, for example, that this bronze woman standing is in a collection in the Netherlands. Its provenance is listed as Dirk Hannema 1922 from the artist, Hannema de Stoers Foundation 1957. The work was in an exhibition at Kunsthalle Mannheim in Germany in 1922, where Dirk Hannema, then director of Museum Boijmans in Rotterdam, purchased it. We found evidence of this transfer in Archipenko's own files. You can see he kept notes on collectors and sales on photographs of his works. On the image on your left, you can see right here in the front, he wrote, that's his handwriting, Museum Rotterdam, and then also on the back of the photograph, there's another reference to this museum. Moreover, what was interesting was that contemporaneous exhibition catalogs also made reference to this collection. Here's, for example, a catalog from Kingor Gallery in New York from 1924. And you can see as number 17, Woman Standing, Bronze, Boijmans Museum in Rotterdam. Now, this was really interesting because as we could confirm this, we could begin to give credibility to other collection information listed in this catalog. And we also learned reading this catalog differently. Previously, people had thought if it says Boijmans Museum Rotterdam, it was a work that was on loan from that museum for the exhibition. But we now learned that actually it meant that there were two bronze examples. One was actually in Rotterdam and one was here in New York at the Kingor Gallery. So it helped us establishing the numbers of examples in an edition. And obviously it also opened up research to a number of other artworks that are listed in this catalog. I felt like hitting the jackpot when I visited the archives of the Kunsthalle Mannheim, where I actually found correspondence from 1922 in which Dirk Hannema confirmed buying the piece and even calculated the price, shipping, and export taxes. So in this case, using information from the artist's own files, as well as exhibition catalogs and archival material, led to a thoroughly documented ownership history. In constructing provenance, we turn to primary and secondary sources as well as to traditional and digital tools. Of course, the issue of available documentation is critical. Records get lost or are destroyed, withheld, forged, or obscured. And even if they can be accessed, they are often incomplete, vague, or inconclusive. The American Association of Museums Guide to Provenance Research explains that, I'm quoting, provenance research is not unlike detective work and must be approached with the same creativity, doggedness, and attention to detail. Our methodology includes different paths of research. If we have access to the object, labels, custom stamps, the material, and other details might provide important clues. Artist files and photo archives, Archipenko's own files, are of course highly valuable documentation. In my case, I find a lot of collection information and sales data annotated on photographs of the artwork. As I said, we targeted institutions worldwide and could trace numerous works. And we also built our own auction sales database, which makes it very easy to identify works and cross-reference. We continue to update this as works sell, and we ask auction houses to forward a letter to the new owner, in which we ask the owner to confirm ownership and let us know if they have other works by Archipenko. In-house, we also compiled a database of names of Archipenko collectors, including names that are connected to unauthorized or questionable works. We also compiled, you see, we have a lot of different databases, but we also compiled a database listing all known relevant dealers with dates and other details, such as inventory numbers. This has become a really helpful tool because a lot of the inventory numbers are the numbers that appear on sales receipts where it just says Archipenko number 8543, but if we know what 8543 is, it obviously helps to connect the dots. Sometimes those numbers are also labeled or written on the underside of a base of a piece, and they help us to identify a specific piece in an edition. Exhibition and literature records can provide important clues. And then we turn to archival material and digital databases and resources here. It's a large variety. They include the Getty Provenance Index databases, Smithsonian Archives of American Art, Nazi-era provenance research portals, IFA website, and libraries, especially the Frick Public Library, the Met, and the Beinecke. And I found it particularly helpful to also use country-specific databases. In my case, those are in Germany, France, and Britain. And it's really, I found it's really all in the details. So we compile miscellaneous information, for example, information on foundries used by Archipenko, their methods of casting and dates of operation. In building our catalogue Raisonné, the provenance research was often one important piece of a puzzle that did not only matter to one specific artwork, but to a larger context. For example, while looking at the German exhibition catalogue from 1955, I noticed that some entries said Berlin Atelier, indicating a mysterious Berlin studio. Previously, no attention had been paid to this detail. It turned out that this was credible information and that it referred to a group of plasters that Archipenko had stored with a marble carver in Berlin at the time of his emigration to the USA. Apparently, the works had survived the Second World War and were now included in this exhibition. This is an image of a page of the catalog which was annotated by Archipenko, and you can read on the top in pencil, "Return from Germany." And he has marked several of the works in pencil. Looking at photographs, installation views, correspondence, and shipping lists, I could confirm that the plasters were indeed shipped to Archipenko in New York. And here are some of them. Archipenko then used several of these plasters as models for bronze editions. For us, this was such important information on many levels. It meant, for example, that we could confirm that the bronze editions were made from the early plaster, which was crucial for dating the works. In ending, I would like to say that with a broader perspective in mind, provenance research can shed light on an artist's practice and its context. I learned to appreciate individual ownership histories as part of larger patterns, networks of relationships and transactions. This opened up a whole set of questions and provided important clues for our catalogue Raisonné. Thank you.
In preparation for today, I was trying very hard not to talk about how fun Noguchi's provenance research is, but maybe there's a little bit of an important fact in there. Noguchi was very urbane, very social. He really did, you know, interact and with some of the leading artists of the 20th century and really interesting people. So the research can be a lot of fun. I'm not as academic as it should sound, but it's recently become a really important part of our work, the provenance research, probably one of the most important parts. Martin Harrison, who's I think finished the Francis Bacon CR, was interviewed recently, and he talks about how much time he actually spends trying to find the works, and that most of his time is now detective work, he says. Because you have to find the paintings before you can do the academic research, and that's sort of where we are now. We've published most of the works in the museum's collection, so now we're basically in outreach mode, trying to get to collections. How are we doing? Oh gosh.
It wasn't just me.
You know, that Zoolander is following me. I missed that. I meant to see that. Isn't that a timeout? So anyway, more and more we're doing outreach. We're trying to find, there's Noguchis all over America and actually all over the world. And the angle that I'm going to talk about today is how provenance chains are kind of the trail of breadcrumbs to how we're finding things. So we're sort of working from a different angle. So my methodology is kind of, in quotes, pretty nitty gritty these days, like Martin Harrison talked about. The first thing is to check, if I have a name, the first thing to do is to check the spelling. I'm checking obituaries. I'm on ancestry.com a lot. I'm in the whitepages.com. Sometimes, the white pages list the other family members at an address, and if I'm looking for an heir, that's helpful. Sometimes they also talk about last known residences. You know, it feels actually like I'm doing a credit search on somebody fairly often. Litigation is hugely helpful. If a collector's been in trouble, there's usually a newspaper article. They sometimes mention what town they're living in. And of course, an artwork raising its head and showing up at auction is a huge help. If everyone's forthcoming, it's basically like getting a look at something's passport. With a date stamp, you know where it's been, you hopefully know where it's going, and that's been a huge help. I'd love to make some generalizations about Noguchi collectors, but he had a long and very varied career. He had a very different audience for every decade of his career. So it's sort of a moving target. The fact is, we're as challenged finding the big, valuable sculptures, which you'd think would be so easy to find, as we are trying to find the small, modestly valued ceramics. Kind of interesting. So in terms of the source material I get to work with, let's see, are kind of forming a first CR in type. There's no way Noguchi typed these out, so I'm sure somebody in his office was cross-referencing them, going back and forth with him. I want to draw your attention to three quarters down the page, Magatama, onyx 6 inches, 1946, John Houston. We're going to come back to that. Can I go back as well? There we go. Oh, great. So this is Noguchi's studio on McDougal Street, no later than 1946. And believe it or not, Magatama is in this picture. We just didn't know it until we found Magatama. It's bottom left. Very small thing. So at some point in the 70s, in preparation for a formal catalogue Raisonné, a bunch of letters were sent out. Those letters with that list that I was showing you are sort of my jumping off point. In the late 80s, somebody figured out that John Houston was John Huston, the director, and the estate was approached about where Magatama was. Houston had a major art collection, including other Noguchis, and the estate writes back saying they haven't seen it since Evelyn Keyes left. So who's Evelyn Keyes? Does anybody recognize her? She would have been so annoyed if nobody recognized her. So I'll give you a hint. Her autobiography is Scarlett O'Hara's younger sister, my lively life in and out of Hollywood. So there's Magatama, actually, and there she is. So this photo here is right after their wedding in 47, but in 46 they honeymoon in New York. They visit Noguchi's studio. They're both avid art collectors. Noguchi seems to have given them Magatama. They divorce in 1950. They split the art collection evenly, apparently. But later on, John Houston decides to go for broke and agrees to flip a coin with her. She gets the entire art collection. So she is, whoops, I go a little too far. So she is. She is his third wife of five. He is her third husband of four and a half. One of the lines from her autobiography, which was so interesting, I always took up with the man of the moment, and there were many such moments. Most of her husbands and beaus were important film industry people. After she divorces John Houston, she becomes engaged to Mike Todd, who's working on Around the World in 80 Days. She gives him Magatama as an engagement gift. He gives it back to her, breaks the engagement because he's then met Elizabeth Taylor, who he proceeds to marry. Evelyn had put a lot of her money into Around the World in 80 Days, so she comes out of it quite well. She then marries Artie Shaw, who sells a lot of her art behind her back and her furs and her jewels, apparently. But somehow Magatama stays in her collection. She passes away in 2008, and at which point, she's just passed away as I start some of this research, and my concern is always with estates, especially with something so small that's not signed. Estates are precarious places for art. Things disappear, things get misattributed. Sometimes heirs think they won't have to pay taxes if they just sort of take it, and then they don't want to talk to us. So I'm just about to start doing all the legwork to contact the estate, and the heir contacts us, and it is an Alan Glazier, who befriended Keyes. She told him the whole story of the work. He is coincidentally, and it's only interesting because of the picture, the partner of Tab Hunter, who was a film star in the 50s, but I just love the photo at the bottom. They agreed to be in a magazine talking about this. So there's this photo, and then 70 years later, there's this photo. So, Magatama goes to Hollywood and never comes back. So what I thought, just in terms of what I'm working on right now in preparation for the next chapter, I decided to focus on an area of Noguchi's work that's probably not as well known. And this is a page from Noguchi's notes of his portraiture. And I'll show you one of the more famous ones. This is George Gershwin of 1931. Provenance research for portraits is a little more complicated, I'm finding. It really helps to know the sitter. It helps to know the context of the commission in the first place. You would like to assume, in most cases, that the portrait stayed with the sitter and then stayed with the family. Yes and no, especially with Noguchi, because a lot of these portraits, they're a likeness of a family member, but they're also works of art by an important 20th century sculptor. So they sort of, a lot of them fall into both categories and take on lives because of that. So I'm basically looking for almost 300 portrait works. He probably did about 200 separate portraits. He spoke kind of dismissively about this part of his career. He called it banging heads. It was an income source, during some very lean years. He does them through to about 1950, by which point he's established he's doing the portraits he actually likes. But, what I'm presenting here, this is Ed Lafranco. And again, the Gershwin portrait, no problem, we know where it is. Nice, clean provenance. This one, we know where it is. Stayed with the family. Ed Lafranco, this is where Noguchi's, it's not just a likeness, it's kind of a work of art. She was known for wearing a monocle to parties. Noguchi, knew a lot of, he was very impressed with women in the arts. They were very impressed with him. This is kind of, so I finally see it and I get to meet the daughter who now has, it's being passed from mother to daughter, which is kind of nice. And I asked about the monocle and she said, because I sort of assumed it was an affectation, and she explained that, no, there's a hereditary genetic eye problem, that they all need some sort of help, and that was what Edla was working with at that point. So this is Ginger Rogers, a terrible photo, but this is in the National Portrait Gallery, and if you could see it in color, there's actually a slight undertone of ginger to the stone, which is very, a kind of Noguchi twist that very typical of them. But these are easy things. When it's a celebrity, it either stays in the family or it ends up at a museum. When he's doing, a lot of straight off commissions, people he didn't know personally that walked into his studio, famous doctors or famous politicians, those have ended up in the logical places, the institutions or the hospitals they worked. But I'm going back to what I've been looking for and what I thought I'd talk about is some of the things here. And welcome to my nightmare. So Basque Foundry's daughter of Anton Kunz, ? I think I did her portrait. And where's the other one there? So Mrs. Conrad Behrens, completely unhelpful because I don't know who she is. I have to find out who the husband is. So there's some letters. So part of the letter writing campaign went out looking for some Mrs. Conrad Behrens, and they seem to have harassed some poor lady in Missouri who took exception to the implication that she was alive in 1935. Everything I'm about to say is pure speculation, but it seems to, knowing the demographic that was having their portrait done, it sort of makes sense. There was a Dr. Conrad Behrens, spelled B-E-R-E-N-S, who was a world-famous ophthalmologist in New York. There were three Mrs. Conrad Behrens, unfortunately. The only one that makes sense logically would be Mrs. Behrens II. So she was, let's see, Catherine Andrea Parker. Now, married him in 23, divorced him in 1940, and immediately, marries John Cheever Cowden, who is the head of Universal Studios. And there's lots of anecdotal information about her steering the casting of some important films. Cowden passes away, leaves her very well off, as if she wasn't well off enough. She then shows up, and this is the next time I'm able to find her. So here she is when she is the chairman of the White House Fine Art Committee in 1961. This is in the JFK Library, and she's the lady with the white gloves. But the reason I'm sort of showing this case study, first of all, I'm hoping somebody will jump out and say, I know her. failing that, this is the first time I actually have a picture of who she might have been and who she might look like. There's lots of places I can continue the research, and maybe next year I will, but my sort of ambition right now is to get a lot of these portraits as far as I can. Either I'm going to do it or the next person's going to do it, and I, you know, footnoted myself like crazy that this is all guesswork, but this is a logical person. She died in 78. She has no children. She's buried at St. Bart's on Park Avenue. Again, there's lots of places I can look, but, you know, it's a bronze bust of and if you don't have a family connection to this woman, it's just a bronze bust of an attractive woman. So my concern always is to find these things so they don't get lost or shuffled around. I actually have found a case study and a very important actress. I'm going to leave all the names out of this. Passes away, and her son inherits the portrait, and I find him by looking up who attended the funeral. Sure enough, he says, oh yeah, I've got it. And he says, we keep it outside. I'm like, you know, it's alabaster. And he said, you know, and when I got your letter, I went out and looked at it, and it's not looking great. And, you know, what I think sometimes happens is people forget they have a work of art. It's a portrait of mummy, and if they have issues with mummy or whatever, it gets confused. So I spend a lot of time impressing on people that, you know, their portrait bust is an important sculpture. So the last one I'm going to do, this is Mary Stevens Baird. So she's sort of typical of the portraits he was doing in the 30s. Really smart, well-to-do, well-connected, amazing women who, you know, either become ambassadors themselves or marry ambassadors, editors of magazines. Really, Mary Stevens Baird was very well-to-do, became very important in the New Jersey government correcting correctional facilities. Easy breezy. I know where it is. I saw it last summer. It went from her to her cousin, and now it's with her cousin's son. It's, you know, a prized family possession. It'll continue to be passed down in the family. The problem, we know there was a second one. And this is where it sort of gets interesting. Noguchi mentioned that he did do a second. Mary Stevens Baird, I'm just going to show you this because it's an earlier photo and it's got a different base. It's sort of interesting. Mary Stevens Baird mentions that a second one was done, and she tells the story that while she was at Oxford, she met, I get his whole name, Lord Astor, the Viscount Lord Astor, Bill Astor, everyone called him Bill. He asked, when he saw the portrait or when he saw that she was getting a portrait, he asked for a copy to be made for himself. She went and chose the marble, she tells in her memoirs to the family. She went and chose the piece of marble. She told Noguchi to charge him through the nose because she knew he needed the money. I was never sure it actually got done. But when I went to see this, the family pulled out this photo, or reproduction of a photo. I'm sorry, it's terrible, but they didn't want to bend the spine of the book for me. So there's Noguchi, there's Miss Baird, there's, I believe, the first portrait, and there's the second. So, you know, everybody kept just saying to me, oh, well, it's with Lord Astor, just call him. So the Astor House is now, it was Cliveden. Cliveden is now part of the National Trust, so you'd think it would be easy, but Cliveden is now a hotel. So they still have curators at the National Trust that are all in charge of this. I spent a good 2 or 3 months in emails being referred on to somebody else. Everybody was really helpful, but you know, everything was a dead end. And finally, somebody said, oh, just contact the present Lord Astor. And why I'm telling this story is because, you know, Provenance Research, you know, what they're actually asking me to do, potentially, is send the son and ask him a question, like, did your father keep a picture of, potentially, or a portrait of his girlfriend around? You know, that's basically what I might be looking for. We don't know what the connection between Baird and Lord Astor was. It's very odd that he wanted a portrait of her, unless there was some sort of romantic, at least one-sided. Mary Stevens Baird is writing to her family in this memoir, so I'm sure she's editing out what the story was. So I finally decide, you know, it's doable. First of all, I'll write him in the House of Lords, and there's a website. There's a very specific protocol of how you address an email to somebody. They actually tell you everything, so I'm copying and pasting. I called a couple of people, friends of mine in the UK, and they gave me a few more. And he was just, you know, I worded it, I think, pretty carefully, because I'm sort of stating the facts without any kind of, and he sent me back this lovely handwritten letter saying he only wished he had it. But I tell the story just as a case study for how delicate some of this has to be, because we are, I'm doing Provenance Research to get into people's homes. And I want to be clear about why I'm doing it. You know, I'm doing it for a good reason, but it is a personal thing. A lot of these are personal property. Full disclosure, I'm in a building with 7 other Noguchis, major Noguchis, in my elevator bank. I've spent a good hour and a half with some of these collectors, you know, but they're all such busy people. I literally ride in the elevator bank. They have no idea who they pet my dog, and you can see they're trying to remember. They've placed me somewhere, but you know, I tell this as a, you know, a lot of this research is about trying to get into the work, to see the work and to get it cataloged, and then to move on to the next thing. So that's where I thought I'd leave it.
Thanks to all of our excellent speakers, Alex Ross, Alexandra Keiser, Elizabeth Gorayeb, and Christel Force. All of their illustrious bios are in our short flyer that we have. Also, special thanks to Elizabeth and Alex for fighting through the curse of the ghosts of Nadia Leger and Mrs. Dr. Conrad Behrens, respectively. I think all of our speakers provided great perspectives and case studies. It's a lot of food for thought, especially mixing up the Calog-Resné world with the emergence of object-based art history or the continued presence of object-based art history outside of the explicit Calog-Resné world. It's a lot of stuff to digest. Speaking of which, we also have reception. But in the meantime, if there's a few burning questions that anyone has for the panelists, we'd be happy to circulate them.
If anyone has a question, let's speak into the mic. Does anyone have a question? Maybe I can start then. I have a quick question. I've sometimes encountered the other side of provenance research when you have perhaps a questionable work and you know something specific about it. And I don't want to go into details. I think we've all had these experiences. Say, you know, the artist never went to a particular foreign country during this period, but the provenance from the collector says they went to this country during that period, and that's why we know it's real. So I've found that occasionally if you share too much with the other side, then the story changes. And so I'm curious if anyone can speak to that, maybe specific or in general, how to balance that relationship when Elizabeth is talking about that sometimes we do end up being a little vague with the market side of it because we've been burned in the past. And I'm curious how we can build trust and work together on that, and any examples you might have to share. No one wants to touch that question. Alex, do you want to talk, and then maybe Gail can talk?
Sure. We have a situation with, because Noguchi, the area of Noguchi's market that's been particularly hot is the furniture, and tables in particular, and a certain table keeps appearing. We want to work very closely with this, with the market, because they are finding things that maybe we don't know about. We keep a really open mind, and I try and keep it as a fair exchange. I'm very, open to the possibility that this coffee table is by Noguchi, but it is exactly as described. The more information I give, the more the story changes. But this one guy who's now found two tables that aren't documented, is very busy. He's genuine and very earnest, but he knows the name of the, he believes he knows the name from the Provenance, one of the owners, and has this gentleman was had a house in the Hamptons. He's absolutely sure Noguchi went to the Hamptons. Jackson Pollock was there, so therefore it has to be a Noguchi table, and it's fast. There's so much money involved that, I'm having to all the time sort of talk him down from the, drawing direct lines between things. But I'm very happy to keep working with him because, God help me if I open a file one day and I find a picture of this table.
Sure. I think it's... it is important to keep the door open because research does come up and it changes things. But I think it's also important to really document and try to document provenance as much as possible. I know it's not always possible, but I think that should be a priority. And I think Katie asked a very interesting question because it crosses over into authenticity. Often we encounter provenances and they repeat and they are attached to clear forgeries. So I'm not going to speak about that. but otherwise, if a collector has an authentic piece and there's a provenance and we know it's not true, we will share that with the collector. And in my experience, they have been very grateful to get that feedback, and especially if we can document it and give them copies of letters or photos. It's been a good exchange for an authentic piece, I may say.
The situation that comes to mind for the art market is the Beltracchi forgeries, which both Christie's and Sotheby's and other art dealers have been burned by. We sold a Max Ernst that was presented to us with the credible documentation of a photograph of a 1920s garbed woman seated at a table, a black and white photograph with this Ernst in the background. And it was totally believable. The forger, of course, created the photograph. So sometimes, it depends on how wily these people are. There's a lot of money at stake. Slipping information into archives. Even I go back to my story about Johns Hopkins University. Maybe somebody slipped that index card in that old dusty box I looked through. People will not stop once they realize how much money is at stake. So, there is an argument to be said for keeping things to yourself, but just always question the source of the information.
Yeah, well, the only thing I would add is that in an ideal situation, the best guarantee is if you can cross-reference several sources which all sort of confirm each other or add elements to the puzzle. And if you find three or four places that confirm the scenario, it's unlikely that they've all been planted, I would say. Yeah. But to come back to the difficulty of getting to the information sometimes if it's not just in publicly accessible records, I remember one time contacting a descendant of an owner and explaining what I thought was perfectly fine, but apparently wasn't. I said, it was about the collection of Roche de Marais, and I explained, surely this was the family of Dardel, who was the boyfriend of Roche de Marais in the 1910s and 20s, and I said, Dardel, whose first name escapes me right now, was very close to Rav de Marais, and he was in charge of acquisitions, and surely, you know, if you have in your family papers some correspondence, it would help. But the fact that I alluded to a relationship, mm-hmm. that was the end. They never responded. So it's so hard sometimes to access information if it's not in an archive that's publicly accessible. If you're dealing with people, personalities, personal history, it's very, very tricky, I agree.